We thank you, Jose, and we thank you for being here. Hopefully, this is going to be a prelude to a Latin forum, if you will, if you allow me the word, on economic conditions under the new dynamics. And we have another event coming up soon on NAFTA, and we will hope to be able to do more things. Jose is a very successful business person. He's also, he was a member of the Moroccan government, right, as an assistant secretary of commerce.
Of state.
Of trade.
Of state. What, of economic affairs.
What's the difference? You want to use a microphone?
Oh, sorry. Just Assistant Secretary of State for Economic, Energy, and Business.
State.
Yeah.
Very good. And I think he's going to have a good no matter what happens next in this fascinating episode in the U.S., Latin American relations and U.S. world relations. And let me just say a couple of things. As a matter of introduction, the moment is a key one, in my view, and it's good that Jose is here to help us contextualize and address issues about changing relations with the U.S. under Trump, Latin America-U.S. relations, or U.S.-Latin America. I mean, look, summarizing a lot of work that many of us have done for many years, Latin America experienced a painful, incomplete, frustrated, a contentious process of economic transformation from the 90s on. New big proposals, one essentially neoliberal, or some people prefer to call it, or I prefer the word liberalizing, meaning let's open the economy to world trade, let's open the economy to investment, let's open the economy to exchange with the outside world, let's deregulate a little bit, let's privatize, et cetera, right? A series of reforms. Those reforms were incomplete, and there was a backlash in the late 90s, and especially coinciding with the commodities boom and the rise of new populism in the Andes, Bolivia, Ecuador, Venezuela, of course, Argentina, and of course, in 2002-3, Lula, in Brazil, although that is, even in the context of so-called populism, really you can argue that many of the reforms that had been adopted before in the 90s and were being in the process of being adopted in the early 21st century were actually maintained. For instance, the public-private partnerships, concessions, the use of alliances between the state and the private sector. So Latin America finds it, but then there was a reaction. In Brazil, I mentioned the PT, and I mentioned Argentina under the Kirchner. Even in Chile, which was normally a pretty so-called neoliberal, liberal society, you've seen some movement toward a populism, backlash, socialism, the big debate of the elections. So Latin America finds itself in the middle of this transition, incomplete, in which reforms were initiated, sometimes frustrated, sometimes they moved along quite a lot. And I think they responded in some ways to the commodities boom, meaning 2001, 2002, because of China, right? The demand for copper, for minerals, for oil, and what have you. You saw an increased demand for the traditional commodities of Latin America and a lot of trade. Now, that collapsed in 2012, 13, began to end. And now we are talking about a period in which there was a reduction in the flat rate, and then possibly now China increasing, growing again, and then that trade perhaps coming back, maybe, that's a question mark. You see in the election of new politicians in Brazil, well, a difficult process, not election. Impeachment accompanied by political realignment in Brazil, in Argentina, the election of Macri, and etc. So you see in Peru, maintaining a court of regimes in place. So you see this difficult, still contentious moment, and then this is when Trump comes into the picture. So is he rocking the boat for Latin America? Is he saying the wrong thing at the wrong time, right? Or is he on target? We don't know. So Jose is going to tell us what he thinks about that particular equation. I mentioned Mexico has a very distinctive, I mean, you can see grosso modo a comparison between South America, which was commodities driven, China, Europe, the rest of the world, and then Mexico, which was also liberalizing under NAFTA since the 1990s. It was a pioneer in the reform process. And Mexico, of course, the path was different. It was closer ties with the US. And that Mexico has done really remarkably well, despite opposition internally under NAFTA. And again, one of the promises of Trump in the campaign was to do away with NAFTA. Trump also did away already with the TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership, which would have linked the Pacific countries in South America, Chile, Peru, Colombia, perhaps Panama with Mexico, and then Asia, and the US and Canada. So that is under stop, but Latin Americans are proceeding. So you see this moment of vulnerability. Change, but vulnerable, but vulnerable in South America, right? And then Mexico, of course, are also in the same situation. So we want to explore those issues, the meaning of the new relations. It would seem that one last point. It would seem to me that I don't know that he's going to do it. In the campaign, threatened to undo the regime of cooperation, if you will, if you allow me that word, between the US and Latin America since the 90s, right? You had NAFTA, you had negotiations under Bush the father, Clinton maintained and deepened those relations, and then we've seen Barack Obama also pursue versions of that and seek better relations, better diplomatic and political and economic relationship with South America, with Latin America as a whole. So are we seeing an end of that cycle of approach? I don't know what word to use. What word would you use, Ken? To that part of the U.S., Latin America, it's not changing, no?
I'm going to let Jose answer those questions.
You know, we need a word for it, but are we under in a moment in which that era is ending, and then we are entering into new terrain? Again, that's a topic that we addressed today, and it's going to be a prologue to a conversation we will be holding here at the Bildner Center for the next few meetings. So we thank Jose Fernandez, as I said earlier, very knowledgeable, very well informed about all these issues. And we want to be able to explore some of these questions. One last point. Latin America is part of the reform process. It's amazing. You know, this week, or last week, or next week, you saw the inauguration of the Lázaro Cárdenas port in Mexico. Did you know that? That's a huge port in the Pacific, devoted to trade with the Pacific and with the US under NAFTA and within Mexico. It's a huge investment in modernization of logistics, in this case, port infrastructure. You see the same thing in South America and Colombia. You see the same thing in Chile. You see, actually, in Brazil, you had a tremendous dynamism in port, well, tremendous, it's a lot happening in port modernization. So Miguel, do we have a PowerPoint with all of these points?
Yes,
please. So what are the five, because they've been talking all these things. So the question is that going to Latin America? Yeah, that's what my main point are now, the threats to the Trump presidency by the problem. Go ahead. Well, I mentioned the growing China role. Brazil, Peru is again increased at the beginning of the 21st century. Exports from that, so trade in South America and Latin America has been very much driven in part and motor by connected exports and imports from China. So that, and this is the Panama Canal, right? And that's expansion of trade in Mexico, but also diversification, the rise of China in trade. What is this here? It's all one. And then the point I made about Mexico's distinctive liberalizing approach, very close to the US in both manufacturing and agriculture, especially the auto industry. Very tight connections. I don't know how Trump may undo or affect that. And whatever. So again, these are the questions we have next for our main speaker. Sorry for the long introduction, but just that background in place. And then I would start to asking you, Jose, what do you agree with that framework? How would you correct it? How would you expand it?
You want me to be here?
You can either do whatever you want.
I'll stand here and then I'll sit and maybe I'll never get up again. So listen, thank you all for coming on what I realize is your part of your vacation time. Appreciate it. I'm a big fan of the Graduate Center. I've been here many, many times and have met with Chase Robinson several times. And I actually call this place one of the jewels of the New York City education system. Place that I very much value. What I'd like to do is maybe spend a few minutes talking about the subject, and then we can get into a conversation. So I remember basically in 2009 when I first got to the State Department, and I was nominated in the summer. It took them about 7 or 8 months to approve me, not because I had anything wrong in my background, but because the dysfunction in the Senate was such that the Senate Foreign Relations Committee literally was not meeting and did not meet for 5 or 6 months. And when I got there, we were in the midst of the Honduras crisis. If you recall, 2009, the golpe, the coup, or the change in government in Honduras. And the reason I start with this is that was really, I got there during an exception of the Obama presidency in terms of dealing with Latin America. If you look at what we tried to do at the State Department, and really for the 8 years that Obama was in office, and then I'll get into Trump because it's really a contrast. It was really a patient type of diplomacy, a diplomacy that was not take the bait. For many of our adversaries. If you, at the time in 2008, if you recall, during the last few months of the Bush administration, Venezuela was rearing its ugly head, Bolivia, Ecuador. We had a number of the pink tide, so to speak, in Latin America was in full force. And the Bush administration and the Otto Reich and Roger Noriega, who were running Latin policy at the time, were really answering. You know, they were making statements on what was going on in Venezuela. They were making statements against Correa in Ecuador and others, and Cristina Kirchner in Argentina. Obama took a different, and basically his approach was, we are not going to waste time on our adversaries unless we really have to, and then we're going to do it reluctantly. You know, countries are entitled to make their own mistakes. And if they don't want to play in the same sandboxes as we are, we'll just let them go on, and time will tell who's right and who was wrong. I think history has been kind to that approach. But Honduras was different. Honduras is a place that we actually had to get involved. But the overall framework of the Obama policy was that Latin America no longer needed crisis management. It was no longer a place that the U.S. Could, in many, many places, make a huge difference in the short term. And we weren't going to play that one. That was a very important shift, I think, in the Obama administration. Enter Cuba. During most of the multilateral meetings that took place during the Obama years, until the establishment of relations with Cuba, any meeting that the U.S. had, be it in Cartagena, be it in Trinidad Tobago, with the Summit of the Americas, Cuba came up. And many of the issues that we wanted to talk about, growth, economic opportunity, and the like, basically were shunted aside. Cuba took over, and so part of the reason why the Obama administration did away with the Cuba policy that had been followed for 2 years wasn't just that it was not being successful, but also because it was just getting in the way of every other discussion that we were having with Latin America. There were many who criticized the U.S. They felt that the U.S. was ignoring Latin America. There were many Latins, on the other hand, who were saying things go well for Latin America when the U.S. just gets out of the way, when the U.S. just ignores us. And there was that view. But I think from the trade side, and then this will get us into the U.S.-Latin American economic relations. From the U.S., from the trade side, our trade with Latin America went up by 50% during the Obama years. And we, in fact, and this can get lost in the rhetoric of the campaign and beyond, the U.S. actually ran a trade surplus with Latin America of about $15 billion. And in fact, Brazil, the biggest economy in the region, actually years was the second largest, we had the largest trade surplus with any country in the world that wasn't just a transit point, you know, not taking into account the UAE or Hong Kong that really don't really import, they just serve as transit points for goods and services from the U.S. But Brazil, after Australia, was the country with which we had the largest trade surplus. So I would argue that the policy during the Obama years was starting to bear fruit. It actually was bearing fruit. The decibel level had been dialed down. The U.S. was seen as a force for democratic good, and our trade relations were improving. Enter Trump, and I will I'll start with the caveat that I am biased. I was very active in the Clinton campaign on the Latin side. Trump basically starts, and then I think then we can get into a conversation. I don't want this to be a soliloquy. But I think I have a couple of takeaways on Trump. Number one, I think things are going to get worse. And I hate to say that because I think we, as I said earlier, we had made some pretty good advances. The Trump approach to Latin America, I would also say, has already caused damage in our relationship with Latin America, damage that I think will take a generation to repair. Let's focus on Mexico, on the wall, on the rapists, and the ugly stuff that has happened. You know, from 1994, when NAFTA was signed, till now, relations with Mexico were actually the highlight in many ways of our foreign relations. People forget that before 1994, Mexican foreign policy with respect to the United States had always been antagonistic. You know, Mexico was the first country, or was the only country that, in fact, refused to break relations with Cuba. Was oftentimes critical of U.S. policy. Starting with Salinas, starting with NAFTA in 1994, that changed And I think I'll never forget when President Peña Nieto got into office in 2012, one of the first things that his advisors did is come to the State Department and say, we want to have, one of our goals is to create a North American partnership, is to create a North American community. Sort of what you're seeing now with the Olympic Games, you know, you're seeing that it's a joint proposal from the U.S., Mexico, and Canada. Well, they came and they said, we want to find a way of just being more competitive around the world by creating a common market, a common approach. And I'll never forget sort of sitting back, and I'm old enough to remember the pre-years, and I remember saying to my colleagues at the State Department, hey, you know, let's take advantage of this. This may not happen again for another generation. So the first thing we did is a month later, just right after he took office, you saw five assistant secretaries of state from all different cabinets show up in Mexico and say, hey, remember what you said? You want to have a partnership with us? We're gonna take you at your word. And we actually followed through. And I think in many ways, the relationship that we had for the last 2 years with Mexico was among the best. You know, we did things that we took care of irritants that had been there for a long time. If you recall the truck dispute where Mexican truckers were not being allowed into the United States, and Mexico was starting to rotate increasing tariffs on U.S. products. So one of the things they did, for example, there was a congressman from Washington State who was against our agreement that we had signed. Well, the Mexicans, one of the first things they did is they increased tariffs on Washington apples. And they did that on purpose. They didn't go after any other apples. They went after Washington apples because that congressman was against the agreement. But we were able to solve those kinds of things. Enter Trump. And this is what makes me, in many ways, very sad. I think our relations with Mexico will not recover for another generation. And I mean that even if Trump were to change his tune right now, I think what's been broken is that sense of trust, that bond, that belief that we had a common future together. And sort of the mercantilist approach to human relations, the mercantilist approach to foreign relations, I think has taken over. And Mexicans, rightly so, have realized that they may not always be able to count on having a good cooperative relations with the United States. At times, it may be adversarial, and that's a change. And that's something that I think has hurt our relationship. It seems to me that, and we should talk about this, I, as I said earlier, I expect things to get worse. I think the rhetoric in the campaign was part of a strategy designed by a campaign that didn't have much support in the Hispanic community, and so it made it an easy, whatever you want to call it, an easy group to go after. It seems to me also that Latin America, in many ways, has rallied to support, seeing a number of countries that have said, well, we will increase trade with Mexico, we will find ways. We'd love to sell you corn. Brazil has said that, Argentina has said that. We'd love to sell you corn. So you may see, in a way, the return of this sort of anti-Americanism on the part of Latin America if this continues. And when I say that things could get worse, I think, you know, and Mauricio mentioned it, we have an election, you know, the Mexicans have elections too. And we have an election in Mexico coming up. And so far, the leading candidate is Antonio Manuel López Obrador, AMLO in short. And he basically has a 31% approval rating. The person who's in second or at this point, and it's a long way away, the elections are a long way percent approval rating. AMLO has shown that he can blow an election. you know, he has snatched defeat from the jaws of victory in two other elections. So who knows what will happen in 2018. But if he does get there, I think part of what he owes his success to is a backlash against Trump. Actually, there's one person, there's one political figure in Mexico that has the lower approval rating than President Peña Nieto, and that's Donald Trump. The Peña Nieto approval ratings are 12% in Mexico. Trump is 6%. You wonder what those 6% have been reading. I don't know. But I do think things get worse, and I think for an administration that really has shown a very little interest in improving that relationship, I think really I see the next few years with some trepidation. So with that, let's have a conversation. Thank you.
Thank you, Jose. Thank you very much. Those are introductory remarks. One reason for my extended introduction was to frame a conversation, which is what Jose wanted. Any questions, let me ask him.
I'd like to come back to the question of U.S.-Mexican and Latin American economic relations. Over the last couple of weeks, people have argued that it looks like there are grown-ups in the room that are bringing Trump into reality, that he's going through a kind of learning process which may make him less destructive than people assumed he was going to be up until the last couple of weeks. And so I'm wondering, do you see any of the of a learning process on the part of Trump and Trump Latin American policymakers? For example, you know, there's all this talk about barring Mexican exports to the or putting big tariffs on them, but a lot of Mexican exports, like the cars, have significant. The supply chain for those cars includes 40% of material produced in the United States goes to Mexico, gets installed in the cars because these are multinational production chains. Is there any recognition on the part of policymakers or the talking heads within the Trump administration of how to deal with that, to recognize that reality, aside from the fact that you pointed out that the United States has had a positive trade balance with Latin America, so that's another counterbalancing factor. But it's Mexico in particular that Trump has made his whipping boy.
You know, there's a hope. Can you hear me okay?
No. Yeah, that's a better one.
Okay. Probably defacing state property here.
Right. We won't report you.
So what you're alluding to is actually the debate that a number of people are having. And it's hard to figure out what they're thinking. But let's give them the benefit of the doubt. And there's this debate, and there has been a debate for a long time, about how NAFTA needs to be modernized as opposed to revamped and with respect to the modernization, there is agreement on the part of the business community, the political community, on both sides, that things that NAFTA did not deal with, such as, for example, e-commerce, are things that ought to be dealt with in a new trade agreement. There's also a view among those same people that that's even more critical now that the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement has been scrapped. Because one of the things that the TPP did is it did a lot of that modernization. It dealt with things like labor rights, environmental rights, that now a number of people are saying need to be incorporated into NAFTA. I would hope so. As I said earlier, even if they are able to reach an agreement, I do think there's damage already that's irreparable, that has been done with respect to the relationship. And I think at the end of the day, what Trump would like to do, and what Wilbur Ross has talked about doing, is increasing the rules of origin, the percentages in the rules of origin. So, for example, the Chinese are investing, and a number of Europeans are investing in Mexico so that they can sell those products in the United States. those the percentages of Mexican-made products ranges in the 40% to 60% range in order to qualify to come under NAFTA. They would like that number to be increased. So that's also, you know, that's a rational discussion. I would, you know, if that happens, that's great. I have not seen any. I've read the same newspaper articles that you have, and I have not seen any proof that that is in fact what they're limiting their discussion to. But at the same time, all it would take is a tweet to change that. And again, I think because of the base that he still needs to feed, I do think Mexico is an easy whipping boy. And by the way, I think, you know, Hispanics have, and I can say this, we bear some of the brunt, some of that, because Hispanics don't vote. You know, 48% of eligible Hispanics vote in elections. That's, you keep doing that, and people are gonna use you as a whipping boy. So, to make a short story long, I would hope you're right. I'm not seeing anything, but what you're saying in terms of modernization is something that the business community has been advocating for a long time. I fear, however, that we are, that time where it's gonna stop.
Thanks, Jose. And I certainly agree with your assessment of the Obama administration's positive effects of benign neglect. Was a great loss. And of course, no one can deny that the impact of China is tremendous, and it's continuing and growing. And again, I find Trump just as repellent as you do, Jose. But his policy on agriculture is surprisingly favorable to Latin America, cutting off subsidies to American producers, cutting the incredible program we have for sugar that costs us consumers tremendously and bars entry to products from Brazil and Mexico in sugar. I mean, those policies, if ever carried through, and I think that's not much chance knowing the politics in Washington, but if those policies were to be enacted, that would actually have quite a favorable impact.
No, you're right, but that would also have the effect of increasing the trade deficit with Brazil, with certain countries, right? I mean, if you let Brazil, although the last time I looked at this, you know, Brazilian sugar was an issue for a while, and you had a number of interests in Florida that wanted to keep up the tariffs.
We know very well who they are.
So my of our countrymen. You know, the Cubans, but the last time I looked, for example, the Brazilians were no longer so interested in that issue because they weren't exporting that much ethanol to the United States.
It'd be sugar.
Yeah.
It'd be sugar.
Yeah. And so they felt that perhaps, and sugar, they felt that perhaps that was yesterday's issue, in the sense that there was not such an interest in exporting Brazilian sugar to the U.S. But I think you're right. But you put your finger on it, which is, will that be carried? You know, how will that play in Iowa? How will that play in places that are critical to Trump's re-election?
Yes.
Thank you very much. With all the terminations or firings by Trump and massive terminations, is there anyone left? And I know my friends are out of the State Department. In the State Department or government offices that truly non-business, who have a truth or with business experience, who really do understand Latin America? Because I don't get the impression, just like with the prosecutors, 46 are where all of a sudden have terminated. Is there people left that have a long history dealing with these governments?
Yeah, I mean, the firings, he's talked about, and they have talked about reducing the budget for the State Department, I think it's by 30%, 25% to 30%, and reducing also the number of civil servants at the State Department. But that hasn't happened yet. What they haven't done at the State Department is they have a fellow who's very well known in Latin America and who really knows Latin America, and that's Tom Shannon. Tom Shannon was ambassador to Brazil, as you know, assistant secretary for Latin America, and he's now the second in command after Tillerson at the State Department. But they haven't named anybody below him, so there's no one to replace my successor. There's no one running the Western Hemisphere desk. There's really no one running any desk other than Tom Shannon as a second in command. The people who are there are quite knowledgeable. Those that I talk to are very discouraged, though, and they, for two reasons. One is they don't really know what the policy is, and that's dangerous, because if you say one thing and your boss says something else, you've got an employment problem. But that's number one. And secondly, what they're hearing, it's hard for a group that has grown up in terms of, you know, cooperation and to try and defend that. So they are very discouraged. I fear that a number of them, the good ones, like anything else, the good ones will leave. They'll do something else. But I think what you have now is just uncertainty. They just don't know what the policy is. I mean, what is our policy towards anything other than Mexican on the wall? And what's our policy with respect to the alliance for the Pacific, with Venezuela, Argentina?
Did you say that Tom Shannon, a wonderful guy, understands the region? He's firmly kind of there now, or he's vulnerable?
No, I think he has a lot of sway. Tom is, you know, he served under Bush II. He served under Obama. He's very professional. He's very well respected, and he served not just in Brazil, but he knows Central America quite well. They sent him to Venezuela when there was a chance of cutting a deal with Maduro. So he's someone who knows the region, but he's overwhelmed. He's not just dealing in Latin America.
But is he the confirmed assistant secretary?
Yeah, he's a holdover from Obama. So he is confirmed. And again, very well respected. So now you have the fellow who took over from Roberta Jacobson, who's still in Mexico, still our ambassador to Mexico. Francisco Palmieri, you know, excellent guy, knows the region. I don't know if he'll be there 3 months from now, but he's someone that we can, going back to your question, you know, I'd have no problems if he stayed. He knows the region quite well.
So Roberta, who is also a wonderful diplomat, face fresh, friend of yours. Mm-hmm. Is she there for a long while, or no? Quién sabe.
Quién sabe. She knows Mexico quite well. She is technically a political appointee, but however, she's a civil servant for many, many years, and so I don't know if she'll be kept or not.
In that line of kind of analysis or thinking, how vulnerable is Latin America to that alleged struggle between the Barones and the more liberal wing of the Trump administration? Steve Bannon?
You know, I think...
Nationalism?
I think Latin America is an afterthought for these guys.
Yeah.
I mean, not just an opinion. I have nothing to prove that. I think, you know, figuratively, they can build a wall. Whatever happens on the other side, I don't think they really care until we get to 2020, and then you'll see something on Cuba, maybe. And maybe you'll see something again on immigration. But I think for now, I think it's, you know, Latin America is taking a back seat, and I think it's a shame. Because as you well know, Mauricio, you know, for many years we had this pink tide in Latin America, and we finally saw a reversion, or at least a, a change politically to governments that were more pro-U.S., you know, Macri in Argentina, and many others. And I think and this was a moment when I think we could have borne the fruits of our patient diplomacy on with Latin America. But I just don't think it's a priority.
Indeed, yes.
Could you go back to what you said before about the influence of China in Europe? And could you expand on that? Because from now, the Latin American perspective, not necessarily from the American
perspective. Sure. It's a great question, and it's a question that I actually, that a number of people have dealt with. There was a feeling at one point that the Latins, well, on the one hand, they were selling a lot of commodities, soybeans and the like, to the Chinese. Chinese trade between 2000 to 2014 or 2015 actually increased from 12 billion at the start of the century to about 290 billion in 2015. So it really boomed. That was the good news, so to speak. The bad news is that was, as many of you have know, it's that was basically commodity. So you were seeing a return to commodity-based exports on the part of Latin America, which is something that economists in the region had railed against. There was also a view in some countries that the Chinese trade was not only turning Latin America back into a commodity exporter, but also was eviscerating a number of the local industries. So for example, the textile industry in Central America and many of these places, the maquiladora industry, was hurting. And it was hurting because Chinese imports were taking their markets away. So that was one view. However, if you talk to, you know, the Argentines, the Brazilian, not, you know, some of the Argentines, Chileans, they would say, hey, there's no problem. We're just selling them all the copper in the world, all the soybean in the world, and they're not hurt. We don't have much of a textile industry, and they're not really hurting us. The Mexicans were a little bit different. The the Mexicans would say, we have a huge trade deficit with China, but basically what we do with China is we import raw materials that we then manufacture in Mexico and sell to the gringos. So that's fine. We have no issues with our trade deficit. We would point out, you know, as part of our diplomacy, that for example, with a place like Peru, the trade between China and Peru was 10, 12 products. It was very limited to those commodities. Whereas the trade with the U.S. was thousands of products, many of them were manufactured. So our argument was, even though we have a trade deficit, our trade is better because we're helping you develop your industry. But I think last year, the Chinese loaned more money to Latin America than CAF and the IDB and the World Bank combined. Okay. Money talks, especially when you have no other sources. And so it's undeniable that the Chinese see an opportunity in Latin America, and they are doing a very good job pursuing it.
They have a lot of consumers.
Yeah.
They have a lot of consumers.
And that's right.
They have a lot of what?
A lot of consumers. And if you see that, you know, and he, you know, Dick knows Peru very, very well. You know, what was Kuczynski's first trip?
China.
To China. He didn't come to the U.S.
He tried to sell blueberries.
Yeah. And so, these guys, the first trip they take is no longer to the U.S. They go to China. Yeah.
Peter Johnson.
Following up on this China, the indebtedness is impressive. It's certainly in three or four countries. But if you look historically at Latin American indebtedness to Britain in the 19th century for infrastructure, or part of the 20th century, the United States for infrastructure and imbalance in trade, there's a pattern here. here that we see in terms of investment, mm-hmm. maybe risky in certain periods in certain countries, but investors are willing to take that risk for some type of payoff. Now, one could question what the payoff has been in the United States for their 20th century investment in Latin America. So if we look at Chinese investment in Africa, it's gone well beyond infrastructure and loans. Mm-hmm. It's gone into immigration of Chinese to take over entire sectors of the economy. So this might be something that we'll see in Latin America, enough immigration there that key parts of the, particularly consumer, consumer activities in the economy will be Chinese controlled, which is somewhat different than just Sears and Roebuck in Latin America, which really didn't have an impact on the broad base of Latin American life, maybe for the elites that shot there in the 50s, yes. So how significant economically will this be to U.S. economic interests when China essentially will be the principal loaner, controller of consumer durables for the broad base of the economy and infrastructure?
That's a great question, and I think, let me give you the easy answer first, which is they will have an impact, and they are already a player, the Chinese are, not on the political side as much. Why not? Well, because history matters. The U.S. and Latin America have a history, for better or for worse, some would argue. The fact that you have 50 million Hispanics here, I think, does make a difference. Those human ties make a difference. Remittances, you know, $25 billion a year from here to Mexico, second largest source of foreign exchange in Mexico after petroleum and above tourism. I do believe the Chinese will eventually rival the U.S. in terms of on the political side as well, which is why I think what's happening now is so damaging with Trump, because sort of this moral, I use that term perhaps in quotes, but moral political sense that you have a family, you have a hemispheric family, that's being torn. And that, in many ways, we were no longer competing with the Latins in our ability to provide financing. We were not competing on the basis of history, on the basis of, quote, soft power. Query whether that's going to continue.
I'm not sure how to come back to the main point, which is the challenges and the opportunities that the relationships have between the United States and Latin America. Because what I'm seeing here is that neoliberal policies have devastated Latin America. And although that has been, and Mexico also, Mexico suffered enormously after NAFTA. We have a huge displacement of population, NAFTA impact on agriculture in Mexico. Okay. It was very, very beneficial for the United States and actually helped Clinton raise quite a bit of money to counter the deficit that Bush father left. So that was fantastic for the United States, but it was horrendous for Mexico. And the disparity, economic disparity within Mexico was horrendous also. One person having the amount of money of millions of his countrymen. So for Colombia, horrendous, has been devastating. It created 6 million of displaced population within the country, Colombia? And many outside. Colombia. We have 6 million displaced people within Colombia. The push for the free trade agreement, which we were able to stop it for 5 years or so, but we couldn't anymore. And it is right now causing enormous problems because there's no agriculture anymore in a country that was self-sufficient. So what I see is that the opportunities for a very strong country like the United States are great, but I see enormous disproportionate difficulties for Latin America if we continue with the neoliberal policies, which I understand Mr. Obama was very favorable of. I don't particularly believe that Mr. Trump is able to do any different. I think mostly talk to try to appeal to a base that is suffering here also. Finally, those neoliberal policies touch the people in the United States and made it difficult for them because they have made huge disparities in income for most of the population within all the countries. So I'm kind of torn because you seem to be defending, Mr. Fernandez, those policies that have been so damaging to the world.
Okay.
How can you defend that? I guess that's my question.
So by the way, I remember being in Libya once and talking about the Libyan, the Arab Spring in the U.S. and in a very big room, and the first question I got was, Mr. Fernandez, why does everybody hate the United States? So I couldn't disagree with you more. I don't think you'll be surprised. I think, because I also disagree with you on the facts. I disagree with you that the free trade agreement has caused 6 million people in Colombia to be displaced. I mean, you have a civil war going on in Colombia, and that I think most people would say has been the main cause of the displacement in Colombia. One of the interesting facts about trade agreements is that oftentimes both sides believe that it's been prejudicial to them. So in Mexico, you have the Mexicans thinking that it's hurt them. In the U.S., you have the Americans thinking. But the fact of the matter is that you know income inequality is a problem throughout the world, including the U.S. and Mexico. But you do have, and this is a fact, 50 million people have been brought out of poverty in the last 15 years in Latin America. That's a number. That's not an opinion. I think we can argue with neoliberalism. We can argue with some of the ravages of neoliberalism. But I would argue that the alternatives that have been followed to those policies have been worse. I would argue that you compare a Bolivia, you know, which talks, which barks socialism but follows neoliberalism. I don't think they would say that there's any other alternative. In a place like Peru has grown 20 years since they started privatizing. They have not had a down year. So I will disagree with you, and I think the numbers bear me out. But that's why we are at a university where we argue ideas, but I don't think we can argue the facts.
But that depends of where you take your numbers. If it's the World Bank, obviously your numbers are going to be. But for example, if we look at the displacement, the internal displacement in Colombia, we have a war for 70 years. But that specific displacement started in 1992, 1995, when after the Reagan administration began to push neoliberal policies all over. 3 months before the collapse of the economy in Argentina, the United States, the World Bank, everybody was saying that that was a model for all Latin America. So, and the economy collapsed. And it was very damaging to the population. So, and the same happened with Mexico. Those are facts. The fact is that Mexico was not sending as many people as it was sending after the NAFTA to the United States. It was has always been some people coming to the United States, but it wasn't in that quantity. So those are facts also.
Yeah.
You can want you,
no,
you
no,
want
but,
to
but,
look at that.
And,
so.
And then maybe we can have this on the side. But look,
yeah.
The Colombian FTA was signed in 2011.
I know.
Okay, that's 20 years after Reagan, or 30 years after Reagan.
Yes.
Argentina, I think most people would say, the issue with Argentina was the fact that they had a parity on the peso, and so they were, which was unsustainable. But anyway, that's for another day.
Okay, those are other ways
yeah.
of putting it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, one other thing about Colombia is Colombia has had a remarkable, in many ways, as I study Colombian history, economic history, it is the most completely liberal country, liberal, economically, in Latin America. It was liberal in the 80s, in the 90s. It has remained more or less liberal. It's true that the relationship with the U.S. were kind of deepened in what year was that? In,
well, with
La
Paz,
Colombia.
Plan Colombia, with 1992, basically.
That was not really
exactly.
Liberal policies. Liberal policies were there for a long time.
I'm not talking about liberal. I'm talking about neoliberal.
No, it's the same. Liberal policy, economically liberal.
But what devastated the coffee trade in Colombia was the relationship between the United States and our President Gaviria that lowered
But before Gaviria, we had what's his name?
Yeah, no.
Emilio Barcos.
Yes. But what I'm talking about is that created a problem with the coca cultivation. We didn't cultivate coca the way that we did after they devastated the coffee cultivation. So, and the United States began to export to Colombia coffee from Vietnam. So this is the kind of stuff that seems to be working very well for the United States, but not so much for Latin America. And I'm not saying that it's not appropriate for the United States to protect and defend its own trade and economic well-being, but it is a challenge because it sometimes has a very negative impact in other countries, especially those that are not strong enough to support say no to.
By the way, I can take 2 minutes and comment from Mexico. My reading of Mexico is that Mexico, that NAFTA and free trade agreements do have losers and winners in all countries. In this country, we had losers and they are still complaining. They complained for a long time. And in Mexico, you did too. And I would agree with you that traditional agriculture in Mexico, ejido, and the small holdings, traditional, which really were not very competitive worldwide.
Yeah, no.
And they could not withstand
No, they weren't competitive at all.
They were not competitive at all. And that was the reason why the Mexican authorities decided to introduce the reforms. Now, they did suffer. A lot of people left the countryside. Mexico at the time was 30% rural. Today it's much less. And a lot of those people migrated to the U.S., to Mexican cities. But then the maquila and the industrial sector, the modern, innovative sector expanded. And they are doing very well in Mexico to this day. And they are the ones defending NAFTA now, or the big champion. So you do have a cleavage. And I don't think it's as simple as it's bad for the whole country. I think it just depends on who gets hit, whether the winners or losers, in my view. But you have a comment.
I just simply say,
echoing what you say, in the case of Mexico, I had a dog food company in Mexico.
Yeah.
Dog food. Sales grew in double digits year after year. Did Mexicans have more dogs? No. They started feeding their dogs dog food instead of scraps. It was a growing middle class, a lower middle class.
Yeah.
And it grew double digits year after year. I don't know where their money came from. It came from someplace because they bought a lot of dog food. And that's all I care about.
But it is complicated. Winners and losers, and it's a political process. I do agree with all this conflict. Ken.
I'll change the topic a little, but it relates to this. If Trump was saying that Mexico stole all our jobs and raped the United States figuratively and literally in the way he was making all those arguments, he never addressed the fact that it wasn't Mexico and foreign trade, but rather automation that really dramatically transformed the workforces and the employment opportunities. And so I was wondering whether Jose can tell us if Hillary would have addressed that. That is, one other point in the setup is that Shannon O'Neill did a blog post on Council on Foreign Relations that I just discovered this morning, didn't have a chance to read it except the beginning and the end, and she had lots of tables there. Her argument was that Latin America is going to suffer in major ways from automation in the way that the Rust Belt, from which I come, has suffered. And so I was wondering, one, did the Hillary Clinton campaign have an element of addressing automation and how to cope with economic transformation in this country and in other countries as well? And does Trump have any, did the Trump team have any idea of this process?
I'm not going to divine what the Trump administration is thinking, but you know, Hillary did have a very detailed position paper on retraining workers, which is, by the way, something that has been tragic is all of these agreements, be it the Colombia Free Trade Agreement, the Panama Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA, have provisions for dealing with the losers, because it is clear that people lose their jobs mm-hmm. because of competition. But the figures that have been spent on that and that are allocated for that are minimal. So I think the number I heard on NAFTA was $60 million for retraining American workers, that which is won't get you anywhere. That's probably your department's budget. Mm-hmm. Those are the kinds of things that I think Hillary was trying to address. How do we retrain? Not how do we sort of protect ourselves and wall ourselves off from competition, but rather how do we deal with the losers so that we can compete at an even higher level than we are now? Well, that's history, and I don't know what, if anything, the Trump administration has in place for retraining American workers.
Peter Johnson.
I wonder if we could put a human face on some of this dealing with Trump. The Princeton has a demographer, Douglas Massey, who has written extensively on the border, the movement of people, the movement of goods, and he has testified before Congress. Clearly, Congress for the last few years, as well as this current administration, are not interested in the facts. There's extensive amount of documentation, statistical, about the movement. So what I think is worth thinking about is that the accelerated movement of minors who are U.S. citizens born to Mexicans who live in the U.S. but have decided to return rather than to be deported. And Doug has data now indicating somewhat over 500,000 children And these are not children of the elites. These are children of the working class in this country, are now in Mexico, and under Trump, the State Department Consular Division apparently has some type of edict simply ignore these people. That's Mexico's problem now, even though they're US citizens. And I live in Queens, and what's really interesting is the local post office, which has a window for passports. Regardless of the day of the week you go in there, there are never less than 50 to 100 people queued, of which at least 50% of those people are Latinos. Then they're Bangladeshis, they're a variety of people with hijabs on, and that, but they have children, all sorts of children, and those kids are the ones that are queued up there for the photo and the thumbprint and all of that. So if you're looking at that just in one neighborhood in Queens, how many times this is being repeated elsewhere as Mexicans and others are expected to be expelled in these sweeps that now will be going through the US. That's going to have quite a ramification, I think, in Latin America as these children go back and
absolutely
are not equipped linguistically or in socially a lot of other ways to live in these societies. We already see the impact in Central America from the expulsion of the Salvadorians and some Guatemalans and Hondurans for the development of the Maras and the integration in the drug trade. So this is a type of situation involving US citizens that I think there's going to be a social implication down the line, and certainly economically. So how, since you've been in both sides of this, what do you think the private sector can do to influence how this is going to play out, both in Latin America, because it won't be limited to Mexico. Lots of parents that don't have all the right documents are going to go back, and those children are going to find themselves in Colombia and Peru and Bolivia. So is it going to be something that the private sector should be looking at, thinking about?
Well, look, this is a much bigger issue than anything that the private sector can address, but you've got, you know, frenemies and people who normally would be on both sides of the debate who are arguing for a rational immigration policy.
Won't happen.
Yeah, it won't happen. I think in terms of what you're seeing in a place like Mexico is, you know, you really have two Mexicos now. You have the border of Mexico, the northern part of Mexico, and the southern part of Mexico. Presumably those people, to the extent they speak English and have those kinds of skills that they gain in the U.S., will be better employed in the northern half of Mexico. I do think that will exacerbate the differences in a place like Mexico. I'm not as familiar with the Central American repatriation issues, but sometimes we forget the fact that we need a rational immigration policy to solve this, because otherwise you're going to see tragedies such as the one you're talking about continue, and there are many others. I mean, it's something that, from a personal point of view, it's you know, you can do what you can, but it's you're not going to solve it on a case by case basis.
Because you have to go back to your job,
go
right?
Back to building some hours, yeah.
The war, Brazil. How important is it? Was it before Trump? And how important is it now to the U.S.?
So Brazil has always had a prickly relationship with the U.S. You know, if you go back to George Bush, you know, when he came out again, he wanted the free trade of the Americas. If you think about it, it was the Brazilians who scuttled that, and now they saw it as a challenge to their regional power. They were flying very high during the Lula year, doing very, very well. You know, a lot of those 50 million people coming out of poverty that I mentioned earlier were Brazilians who were brought out of poverty by Bolsa Família, by the educational policies of the Lula administration. I think Brazil now is going through some very difficult times. I mean, you've got a never-ending, endless corruption debate. My hope is that at the end of it, once we see the light at the end of the tunnel, that you'll see a better Brazil. But Brazil, the political class, is rotten. It just seems to be endless.
It's learning.
Yeah, but it just, you know, today there was a an article that Mauricio Odebrecht has admitted that in 2 years they paid $3.3 billion in bribes.
Huh? It was 9 years. Don't be. They did 750 during the last two. That's right. But it's still.
Yeah. But who's counting, right?
So therefore.
The optimist in me, and you see what you're seeing in Brazil, you've seen it to a lesser extent in Mexico, where they have tried to pass a corruption law. You've seen it in Guatemala, and to some extent in Honduras. You're seeing it in Peru, you're seeing it in other places, Chile as well. My hope is that at the end of the day, something that we've all talked about, which is the corruption that's endemic in Latin America, that there'll be some improvement. But I think in the short term, I think you'll see politically Brazil hobbled by this scandal. Economically, people forget they're running a trade surplus these days. So the Brazilian economy has bottomed out. But the political class, I don't think you're going to see much change until the next election, at best.
Well, let me rephrase the problem. Politically challenged, a big problem, but making slow movement towards some kind of economic solution, slowly better.
Yeah. They've had
perhaps in the better cases.
They've had three.
Therefore, what does the U.S. do?
Again, I don't think Trump will really pay much attention to Brazil. I don't think the U.S. does anything. I think this administration, they don't need the Brazilians to do anything in the Middle East. They don't need the Brazilians to. And I just don't see much of an emphasis on Latin America, period.
But security is a major issue. It destabilized Brazil, destabilized Mexico, destabilized America, Central America. Would be a big headache for the U.S.
Yeah, but Brazil is not going to be that unstable.
That close, though.
I think you always have the issue with Paraguay and the triangle. But I hate to say it to a group that's interested and someone like me in Latin America, I just think, you know, we will fall even further off the radar screen in this.
I think that will be a huge mistake. What do you think, Ken?
No, I just wanted to, when we're talking about destabilizing and things like that, nobody's mentioned Venezuela today. Mm. And when we think of major problems, Brazil has a long history of muddling through.
Mm-hmm.
And for Venezuela, the situation looks much more alarming. And so I was just wondering.
So you're optimistic about Brazil?
No, I didn't say
muddle
optimistic. If muddling through is optimism, yes.
That is optimism.
So on
Venezuela.
During the Obama administration, we put on some sanctions on Venezuela. We once in a while would make a statement, but for the most part, Obama stayed out of the way. That anything that the U.S. did typically fed into the narrative that Chavez had, which was a big bad imperialist wolf. Mm-hmm. And so we weren't really, why throw? If your enemy is drowning, why throw a lifeline? It was sort of like the view. And it was the belief was that at some point Latin Americans would have to come to the fore and would actually have to deal with that problem among Latins. That's happening in some ways. You have Luis Almagro at the OAS, God bless him, really taking a very courageous stand on Venezuela. Venezuela has a lot of tentacles because of Petrocaribe, so a lot of the little Caribbean countries, even countries that we would think would follow the lead of the U.S. and others, such as Haiti, Dominican Republic. These are countries that are supporting, that are voting against Almagro in the OAS. I think ultimately, and you've seen Trump, on the other hand, has made a couple of statements on Venezuela. I don't know what he's got in mind. I don't think he's going to send the Marines anytime soon. So I don't see him playing, again, much of a role. But I do think that eventually the OAS will play a role. It seems to me, a number of the things we've talked about, you know, there are reports out there that a lot of the Venezuelan oil is not being sold in the market because it's actually being sent to China in payment of some of the loans, so they're getting less. At the same time, last week they paid $2 billion in debt at the expense, if you listen to people like Ricardo Hausman at Harvard, at the expense of feeding their own people. It's a meltdown, it's a tragedy, and I just don't see the U.S. getting involved. And I hope, although I think it's questionable, the Latin American community will become involved.
Caribbean. Cuba.
Cuba. Well, I think, you know, Trump has succeeded in functionally reimposing the, or freezing the embargo, in the sense of there is no company out there that's going to invest in Cuba with Trump talking the way he is. So even though he's not changing the policy, in many ways, investments in Cuba, I'm hearing, are drying up, at least from the U.S. and from others, because of the fear that at some point Trump will do something. You know, he said something during the campaign. Demographics of the Miami community are that most young Cubans, Cuban Americans, want to see a lifting of the sanctions. I don't think we'll see much in Cuba until we get to 2020, and then you'll see some rattling again.
Until we get what? 2020.
Yeah.
May I ask one?
Very fast. Yeah. This is about the free trade agreement, the NAFTA agreement. Do you think is any possibility that Trump actually gives away with that free trade agreement just because it's reaching its 25-year?
You mean he gets rid of it?
Is that any possibility? And
it's a possibility. But it's not. It's unlikely.
Unlikely. And what about the Chapter 11? Can that be modified to be less burdensome on the peoples and more fair to democracy?
Which is chapter?
Chapter 11 is the chapter that protects corporations from any losses.
No. You're talking about investor-state arbitration. Is that what you mean?
But it really, in actuality, protects the corporation, even regardless of where they are.
Well, I couldn't disagree with you more, but I think
it's not nonsense. Anyway. There are many corporations right now, precisely.
They get sued and they win and they lose. It's a lawsuit. But I don't think you'll see. In fact, one in the notice that he gave to Congress, one of the things that struck people is that he said nothing about changing the investor-state dispute mechanism. If that's what you mean, I don't see that changing. Look, my sense is that he will try and do something. It could use some improvement, but I don't think he'll do away with it. There's just too much business out there that's against it.
Jose, one last question. What's to be done, to coin a question? We could, the U.S. could simply benign neglect, let it happen. Democrats, people want to see something a little different, who want to maintain a critical debate or discussion of these things. Another one might be to simply go back to the idea of a forum. Perhaps there is an opportunity now to inaugurate more discussion, alternative mechanism. We're going to propose the idea they were proposing of a Latin economic forum in New York City, which I think is a wonderful idea. I'd like to see that happen, actually. At the moment, is that something?
I think groups like this, do not underestimate your the importance of a place like this. You will have an ability to to invite policymakers, opinion shapers. I think it's important that we keep the dialogues. At some point, again, I'm biased, and I started that way, saying that. I think at some point, you know, rationality, normalcy will return. It's important for us to keep the relationships and to have a rational dialogue of the pluses and minuses of the relationships and of the importance of Latin America. And I do think in, you know, having forums here, having Latin American Historical Association meetings and the like, that's important because that's, to me, that's how you keep the flame alive. And that's part of the reason, frankly, why when you asked me to come, I wanted to be here. I think it's important to keep doing this.
I couldn't agree more. Well, Jose, thank you so very much.
Thank you.